Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all notifications are turned off during the meeting, and we've received apologies from Miles Briggs and Pam Gosol, and Stephanie Callaghan will be joining us online this morning. And the first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed? Yep, we're all agreed. Thank you. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Council Tax Variation for Unoccupied Dwellings, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023. And we're joined online by Timothy Douglas, who's the Head of Policy and Campaigns at Property Mark, Fergus Walker, who's the Revenues and Benefits Manager at Argyll and Bute Council, Gareth Waterson, who's the Corporate Director of Enterprise and Sustainable Regeneration at Orkney Islands Council. And in the room, we're joined by Ailey Kay, who is the representative from Living Rent, and Councillor Bill Lubbin, who's the convener from Highland Council. And we'll try to direct all our questions to a specific witness initially. But if you'd like to come in, please indicate to myself or the clerks. And also, if you're online, you can indicate that you want to come in by typing R in the chat function. Also, you don't need to operate your microphones. We'll do all of that tech stuff for you so you can focus on what you want to say. And I'm going to start with a couple of general questions. And this one, the first one actually is for our three council participants. I'd be interested to hear your sense of the pattern of second home ownership in your council area and what impact they have in local communities. So maybe I'll start with Bill, and then I'll go to Fergus, and then Gareth.
Well, certainly there are positive and negative impacts from second homes. There's no doubt about that. Second homes provide a general increase in tourism income, and that's really important, especially in places like the Highlands, because tourism is our main industry. But also it causes significant problems because it reduces the availability of housing, particularly affordable housing, so that you get many businesses, for example, who no longer can provide accommodation for the staff because there is none. The market tends to be swamped by second homeowners, also by short-term lets, et cetera, et cetera. So that is a significant problem. So that's some of the advantages and disadvantages.
Thanks very much. Fergus, your perspective?
I'd very much mirror what Highland Council said there in terms of the impact on the communities. We've announced a housing emergency, so we have got some significant issues with the lack of available accommodation, specifically some of our smaller communities on the islands, for example, where the number of second homes and long-term empty properties can be way over 25% of the overall properties available on these islands, which gives significant challenges in terms of the sort of viability of local communities. And it's not only a lack of accommodation for Indigenous communities, but it also reduces the ability to maintain lifeline services such as fire, police, education and healthcare due to a lack of suitable accommodation. And the same effect can be felt by the commercial companies, which struggle to accommodate the workforce when there's a lack of available accommodation on these in these places. It does have a significant impact. It does need to balance with the impact on tourism and the economy. Tourism is obviously very, very important to us, and it does, second homes do generate extra income for local economies, so there does need to be a balance there. But you know, we would very much support the double charging of second homes in these, or at least having the powers to do that in our local economies.
Thanks very much. And Gareth? The view from Orkney.
Yeah. Thanks, Chair. Yeah, very, very similar to previous two speakers. I think another couple of things is second homes tend to be in the lower banded properties. Our about 35% of our second homes are in Band A. So those are the sort of the houses that the people trying to get onto the housing ladder would probably be going for. So you've got that as a dimension. And the other thing is the ageing population that we have in particularly our island areas or our islands, outlying islands, and the lack of accommodation for younger people or families in there to sustain the care and support for the community is another another aspect to add in. But, you know, I agree with everything else that's been said previously.
Great, thanks very much. That detail's quite helpful, thank you. I'm now going to ask actually the same question to Timothy and Ailey. So just what your views are around the current pattern of second home ownership and the effects of local communities in general. So if I go to you online, Timothy.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the opportunity to give evidence today. I think from Property Mark's perspective and our members, as have been said, we'll acknowledge, you know, the positive and the negative benefits of second home ownership, and the balance needs to be struck in terms of people being able to buy a second home, but the need and the needs of tourism, but also the needs of supply and adequate housing for people in local communities. I think, you know, from our point of view, even if you look at the Scottish Government's own figures on second homes, I think it, apart from, you know, last year and 2020, you know, there's been a steady decline in second home ownership, according to those figures. And whilst, yes, these measures are discretionary, will be discretionary for local councils, it doesn't tackle the crux of the problem. And the crux of the problem is supply, and that supply of housing for council housing, affordable housing, homes for people to rent, and homes for people, first-time buyers to buy, but also has, as has been mentioned, for the elderly population, right-sizing as well. And I think that gets us on to the point about taxation. Now, these properties, second homes, have already been taxed, certainly in the last 12 months since December last year, 6%, a 6% additional dwelling supplement. So whilst, yes, this is discretionary, I think we would question at Property Mark the use of that 6% ADS money that the Scottish Government have gained, and how that is being disseminated to local councils to tackle this problem and the wider housing problem.
Thanks for that. Just a follow-up question for you. So it's great that you recognise there needs to be a balance, and I just wonder if you have an awareness of kind of particular areas of concentration from your data, from your members around particular areas in Scotland that have that pressure of more second homes and that impact.
Yeah, it's not something specifically that we have data on, but anecdotally we know from talking to members in Scotland and across the UK, it does tend to be the pressure in, you know, tourist hotspots, where that is the pressure for local communities trying to get on the housing ladder, and there is you know, whether that's a reality or perception, that second homes are being sat empty and not utilised, when I think there's a perception from local communities that they could be used. But fundamentally, that comes back to supply. You know, we're not building enough homes, and we're not building enough homes across different tenures to give people those options.
Okay, great. Thanks for that's useful. I'm going to bring in Ailey, and then I see that Councillor Lobbin, you've indicated you want to come back in. So, Ailey.
Hi, thank you, Convener, for inviting me to speak today. I think the points that I was going to make have been well covered by others, but obviously it's Living Rent's position that we're in a national housing crisis, and we welcome the government's effort to increase housing availability. I think when we talk about supply, though, it's important to consider timeframes and interrogate the type of tenure, and incentivising use of empty homes and second properties is a lot quicker of a turnaround than building council houses. It's also typically cheaper for councils to renovate and bring back empty homes into council use than it is to build new council houses, and it's often greener as well. Just in terms of the effect that second homes and empty homes and secondary lets have on supply, of, as discussed, it increases the demand in local areas, and it also increases rents as well as local property prices. So by removing some second homes and secondary lets from the market, overall tends to have a positive effect for both tenants and homeowners.
Great, thanks very much. Bill, you want to come back in?
Yeah, obviously I can only speak for Highland, but in Highland, for example, there are approximately 4,000 second homes who pay council tax. And nationally, I think the figure is only 24,000. And we have a tiny proportion of Scotland's overall population. So in Highland, it can be, in some areas, an absolutely massive problem. And particularly in my own ward of Badenoch and Strath's Bay, there's a chronic shortage of housing. And part of the chronic shortage of housing is caused by second homes and short-term lets. And the balance is the one thing I would agree with. The balance needs to be redressed. It's not about eliminating second homes entirely. It's about just shifting the balance.
OK, thanks. And Fergus, you wanted to come back in.
A lot of the comments been made there, but I'd just like to say, in terms of the trends for in Argyll and Bute, we have not seen a reduced number of second homes in the last few years. Certainly since COVID, the number of second homes has increased again back to the level it was at in 2017. So it was declining, but it's since COVID, it's gone back up again. So we are seeing an increase now in our second homes, and it's putting a lot more pressure on us in terms of availability of housing and the provision of services. But I do agree with some of the comments made by Mr Douglas. I think there needs to be wider consideration. I think this legislation is definitely a step in the right direction, but the housing system is complex, and we need to consider things holistically. And in Argyll and Bute, we'd be keen to look at maybe being a bit more ambitious and have some more wide-ranging considerations of the issue of housing stock availability and how it's negatively affected by the impact of second homes, holiday lets, long-term empty properties.
Okay.
That's the position of Argyll and Bute.
Great, thank you very much. I see you want to come in, but I'm going to move on, and maybe because we've got a lot of questions and we might cover that, or you can tuck your response in. Thanks very much. So this is a question again for our councils, council representatives, and it's going back in time, pre-COVID. So what I understand is that in 2017, councils gained power to reduce the council tax discount on second homes. And I'd be interested to hear what impact the change had on the number of second homes in your area. Bill?
Almost none, to be perfectly honest. I think it didn't change very much at all. The increase in basically we introduced the 100% charge, and that barely dented any impact that second homes would have. And I think that's, you know, collection rates are still well above 99%, so I don't think in that particular case it's had any impact at all.
OK, thanks. Gareth, what about in Orkney?
Again, no discernible difference through the reduction in the discount in Orkney. I think some of the things that in this regard worked against us has been scoring very highly in the best place to live in the UK on those types of things that attracts quite a lot of people to either retire to Orkney, which is another issue, or to come and get a second home. And you know, that was the sort of position that we didn't really see any discernible difference.
Okay, thanks. And Fergus, how's it in Argyll and Bute? How was it?
We did see when we got the ability to increase the charge, if you like, or remove the 10% discount and increase the charge to effectively the same rate of council tax. We did see a small reduction in the number of second home properties, going from around about 3,400 in Argyll and Bute down to about 3,100. So there was a movement down the way over a number of years. But as I said before, since COVID, that has significantly increased again back up. We're now up at 3,234 properties.
Okay. Thanks. And I'm going to stick with you and just tuck another question in. I'd be interested to hear if there's been discussion in Argyll and Bute in the area about whether you'll charge a premium for second homes and what process you'll undertake to make final decisions. And have you got an estimate of the likely income from the increase?
Yes, so there has been discussions in Argyll and Bute already about charging a premium on second homes, and there is a proposal going to council actually on the 23rd of November, later on this week, that says we will, if the legislation and regulations come through, we do propose to charge 100% extra on second homes. Should we do that, And given our the number of second homes in the Galen Butte, I reckon we'll be billing about £4.9 million in additional council tax next year. And very prudently, I'm suggesting that we'll collect about £4.2 million. That's really probably quite low, to be honest, but I've just used, and suggesting to the council, I've used the prudent rate of an 85% collection rate, which is the same that we use, that we currently recover on long-term empty properties. Although, to be perfectly honest, I'm pretty sure we'll collect more than that. So that's the position of our Galen Butte at the moment.
Thanks very much. Very wise to be prudent on those numbers. How about in Highland?
We reckon that the impact will be somewhere financial, be between £4 and £5 million, depending on the collection rate and other things, obviously. But we would expect, even quite prudently, the collection rate to be much higher than the 80-odd percent that's been mentioned. We would expect it to be well into the high 90s.
All right. And you're going to go for the 100%?
We would be, yes.
Yeah. Great. OK. And Gareth in Orkney?
I haven't got a paper drafted yet, but based on our record of increasing council tax last year by 10%, I think the council will be minded to apply the full 100% if it can. And that would, if there are no changes in the numbers of properties, give us about £550,000 of additional council tax revenue.
OK, great. Thank you very much for that. It's really helpful. Now I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, everyone. I would just like to get your views on whether you think the proposal will actually affect change here, whether second homeowners will, in fact, change the way they use their property. And I'd like to ask a view around the table, if I could, starting with you, perhaps, Bill.
Well, I think it will make a change. You know, at the moment, I think 29% of those who have second homes claim that they will then sell their property. Now, whether that's the case or not is obviously will be down to individual circumstances. But that could be part of the good things that we would see, is that maybe these properties will go back into the general housing market, and that really would need to be applauded. Alternatively, if they retain them, and then we have the increased income, that will also assist. So really, I think that's a good thing rather than a bad thing.
Thanks, Bill. Ailey?
Yeah, I think it will. Obviously, Living Rent would like to see this delivered with another programme that would specifically target people who are looking to sell second properties, either into council buyback schemes or encouraging them to put them on the long-term rental market. Obviously, when we talk about policies like this, like the statement of purpose for this is to increase housing supply, but I think we also should consider that it's about changing behaviour as well, in that we should really be focusing and ensuring, and a policy like this would do that, that everyone has a home to live in before people can own second properties. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Any hands up in the online? Will it actually bring about the change that we hope it may do in the policy, to ask her colleagues in the islands?
Timothy, you want to come
in? Tim?
Great. thank you very much. Just waiting there. I think from our point of view, we surveyed our member agents in Scotland on this issue around charging council tax premium on top of regular council tax rates for second homes. I mean, 75% either disagreed or strongly disagreed with the proposal. And I think, you know, when we then sort of asked them around the, you know, those who disagreed with, on the impact on the impact of the proposals would have, you know, there's sort of three things that came out of it. You know, agents just didn't think it would increase the sale of second homes. It wouldn't lead to, you know, an increase in homeowners. And then there was concern around, you know, landlords moving out of the short-term lettings industry and reduction in demand for buying homes to rent. So in that sense, you know, we're struggling to see the effects of this property. Now, there are, you know, precedent and things to look at. The Welsh Government, for example, earlier this year in April, yes, we're still only roughly 9 months on from that, but they increased the ability for local authorities to increase council tax premiums on second homes and long-term empty property to 300%. Now, again, you know, 79% of our member agents in Wales didn't see that as an effective mechanism for tackling the housing issues there. And actually, yes, I acknowledge it's early days, but we haven't seen, you know, we've only seen a minority of local authorities choosing to adopt that higher premium on second home. So I think that is something for both the Scottish Government and, you know, the committee to monitor alongside the, you know, the decisions in Scotland. And I think finally, just to pick up on what the previous speaker was saying, yeah, I think the property might certainly say there's more, you know, there's other measures. How are local councils looking at leasing schemes of these properties? Are they engaging with the second homeowners if they're being left for a long time? You know, why, you know, engage with them on a leasing scheme. We've obviously had the licensing of short-term lets has come in, and other governments across the UK are now looking at that following what Scotland have done. And I think the other area, finally, is probably on business rates and obviously the disparity there in terms of if it's a holiday let and the sort of let for a minimum of 70 days versus you know, only lived in for 25 days on the council tax. It's just whether that should have been looked into in more detail to balance things out.
Okay, thanks for that.
Fergus wants to come in.
Yeah, it's just to say that, and again, we do think this is a step in the right direction, these new draft regulations. We do think it will have an impact, although we think there probably needs to be more done. And I know that next year that we'll be considering increasing the council tax by up to 300%, just like they're doing in Wales at the moment. Obviously, some learning from Wales would be really useful to see whether what the impact is in the first year that they've had these powers. And we don't have that yet, so yeah, we'll see where that goes. But as I said before, there needs to be a bigger and wider consideration of some of the other issues that affect the availability of housing stock, such as planning permission, and also possibly also in relation to sort of the ability to maybe place title burdens on new residential property, which is not specifically applied for as a second home or holiday. We think these sorts of powers would be really useful if we could maybe have some powers around about these areas to stop people converting properties that possibly should be lived in as a domestic dwelling to potentially second homes or holiday lets. That's possibly something we're further down the line. It would hopefully increase the availability of housing supply locally, but we certainly think this is a step in the right direction.
And Gareth, you want to come in?
The point that Councillor Lobbin was making there, I think if the funding that was raised was going towards the reinvestment into housing, you know, we've been doing a couple of initiatives with Island Housing Development Trusts and putting some assistance towards them, which they are using to supplement Island and Rural Housing Fund funding. To allow the development trust on the islands to build houses in their local area. We don't have a huge waiting list, but that's for social housing in those areas. But that's perhaps because there is very little social housing there, and so we don't have that as a metric. But the communities certainly believe there is real demand in their areas, and so if the funding that's raised through this were to be directed to reinvestment in housing rather than just going into council tax coffers, I think that would be something that I would think could make a real difference.
Thanks very much for that, Gareth.
Yeah, thanks very much for that, everybody. You were kind of anticipating my next questions anyway about the Welsh experience. But in terms of potential other incentives, Tim, you led on a few examples there, leasing perhaps. Do you see other mechanisms being used alongside this measure or instead of this measure? And maybe a view from around the panel would be helpful too to balance that. So back to you, Tim.
Yes, thank you. Well, I think fundamentally, you know, what I think there needs to be some greater research really into the causes behind second home ownership and, you know, what leads to homes becoming empty for long term and their usage. And that will obviously, you know, vary across the country. So I don't think we know enough about, you know, the causes, and then obviously that leads to policies that are one size fits all. I think, you know, as I said, the majority of our members disagree that, you know, a higher tax premium should be applied. Those who did agree, 50% said the tax premium should be at 50%, roughly around 37% said it should be at 100%, and 12% should be at 200%. So I think there's probably there an acknowledgement that this is, you know, the direction of travel in terms of policy. But as I say, it does seem, you know, an additional tax perhaps on wealth, considering that if you've bought a second home, you've already paid an additional dwelling supplement, which leads into our point around the redistribution of that money. But I do think, you know, a licensing scheme potentially should be, or a leasing scheme, sorry, should be looked at into by local authorities as an alternative.
Thanks, Tim. Ely?
Obviously, we've been talking a lot about supply, and I think it's really important that we interrogate what type of supply, and ideally we'd want to say that council homes are predominantly the outcome of this. So I think what would be needed alongside this is the delivery of greater powers to local authorities to buy back these properties, whether that's through financial assistance from the Scottish Government, but also that changes to the planning system are considered as well. I know we've touched on what the Welsh Government are doing, and I imagine we will again, but they, alongside their policy programme for this, they delivered changes to the local planning system. Oh, sorry, gave the local authorities the power to change their planning system, in that second homes would also require planning permission, and that creates a specific class use so that it's better and easier to track things like taxes. I guess what I'm trying to get at is that when we're talking about second homes, what we're covering is a very broad topic here, and there's three distinct uses. So there's empty homes, there's second homes, which are holiday homes, and then there's secondary lets. And I think some consideration or sense of discretion into how the three different property types actually affect local supply is important, because obviously empty homes, the approach to that and how to incentivize use for that is obviously very different to, say, reducing the number of secondary lets or holiday homes as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thanks, Ely. Bill, any view in this, other incentives or other mechanisms?
I think one of the things we could do is we could remove the short-term the small business bonus scheme for domestic-type properties. The small business bonus scheme is a great idea. It really incentivises small businesses, startups, etc. But it, the impact it has on domestic properties is quite out of proportion to the benefit. Because what can happen is that If you have a short-term let, or if you have a second home and all of a sudden you move it to a short-term let, then you can apply for a small business bonus scheme if your income is below a certain level, which means you pay neither council tax nor non-domestic rates. And that, I don't think that was ever the intention of the policy, and it's a glitch in the policy that really should be removed.
Thanks for that, Bill. Any other views on that issue about alternatives?
Just wanted to come in.
Absolutely brilliant. Small business bonus scheme. That really should not be applicable for self-catering units and non-domestic rates. He's absolutely spot on, I think, with that comment. And just coming back to something that Mr. Watterson said from Orkney, I wouldn't necessarily... I think he touched on maybe ring-fencing some of this income for affordable housing. I think in Argyll and Bute, we wouldn't really be supportive of that. We're really keen that we have the discretion to use that additional funds in any way that we see fit. I think the reason for that really is that we're already ring-fencing over £2 million worth of council tax income every year for affordable housing. And the issues about creating or building affordable homes is more than just about the money. And also, we'd be really keen to use the funds to support essential services, infrastructure development and community projects as well. So we wouldn't be supportive of ring fencing these additional funds. And just to to reconfirm, I really support what Councillor Loban said around about the use of self-catering units, non-domestic rates, and hopefully not applying the small business bonus scheme to that, because I do think that was the policy around about that was to support genuinely small businesses and not necessarily effectively self-catering units which are being let out for sort of housing and tourism.
Thanks, Fergus. Anybody else online?
Timothy wanted to come back.
Timmy, yeah. You want to come back? Yeah.
Great, thank you. Well, it was just to pick up a point one of the previous speakers said in the room. I think it is important to define second homes, and I think as you know, housing has become more complex with the addition of you know holiday lets and the increase in short term lets. Governments do need to look at you know some form of typology of second home ownership. And I'm going to mention it again, it goes back to that additional dwelling supplement that actually we need to meet the huge demand crisis that we've got in the private rented sector, yet they are still paying, you know, a housing provider in the private rented sector, a landlord purchasing a buy-to-let property is being taxed the same as a second homeowner where potentially that property's is not being used as we're discussing today. So I think alongside that research into the causes of secondhand ownership and empty homes, we do need to look at a typology of that second home ownership that actually I think would lead to more progressive policies, certainly around LBTT and additional dwelling supplement that would support demand in the private rented sector and perhaps squash demand in the second home area where it's not necessarily needed or we're tackling the challenges today.
Okay. Thanks, Tim. Colleagues, you mentioned the Welsh experience, such as it is so far. Tim, you introduced some commentary around in your submission about the experience in Wales. Have you anything to add to that? Have we anything we could say from our experience about what's happening in Wales that could help us shape and drive this policy?
I think only that it's early days. You know, we're not seeing, we've only seen a minority of local authorities choosing to adopt the higher premium. So I don't know whether that is more of a question for the councils themselves in terms of the administration, the appetite, and whether they see the benefits. So I think from that point of view, it's early days. At this stage.
Okay, thanks, Tim. Healy?
Yeah, I think one of the other things that with the Welsh government, what they've done is they've also increased the days to let before a short-term let is eligible for non-domestic rates. And as Bill touched on, there's so many short-term lets across the country which don't pay anything in either council, in non-domestic rates because of the short small business relief scheme. So Andy Whiteman, the former MSP for Lothian, actually did a report back in 2017. Sorry, I don't have any newer statistics. But because of the relief scheme in Edinburgh, so these numbers just pertain to Edinburgh, that before the relief was granted, the short-term lets on the non-domestic rates valuation would have paid £8.5 million roughly in rates. But because of the the small business rates relief scheme, the total that Edinburgh City Council received for a year was £3.7 million. So that's a difference of £4.8 million thereabouts. So this is a massive loss of revenue. And I think what the Welsh Government have done is that they've increased the days actually available to let to, I think, 252, so that because it's based on the valuation rate, right? In that you're covering most properties and ensuring that they're paying either council tax or non-domestic rates, so most aren't eligible for small business rates relief. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah. So you're encompassing all into the local taxation policy rather than giving, you know, having this kind of break in the middle where a number of short secondary lets aren't paying anything.
Okay, that's really helpful. Really. Yeah, thank you very much for that. Just one follow-up question, if I may, Ariane.
Yep.
I'm curious about whether we have any figures, but probably this one's for Tim, but have we got any figures, Tim, on the percentage occupation of a second home, the average occupation per year of a second home? Maybe council colleagues might have a figure on that, but if you've got a house and you live in it, it's generally 100% occupation, isn't it? What is it for a second home?
I think that's very difficult. We certainly don't have approximate figures on that, and I think that is the I think that's the million-dollar question. And I think that leads into any policy discussion in trying to tackle the issue of, you know, short-term lets or holiday lets as well. How long is a short-term let? How short is a short-term? So, no, it's not something we have data and information on, but would be interesting to know.
Okay. Anybody else? Any idea what the percentage occupation is? No. Okay. Nope. I'll leave it at that. We might follow that up.
Oh, sorry. Gareth from Orkney wanted to come in.
Yeah, I think it's perhaps slightly anecdotal, but if you consider what people have got second homes and their annual leave entitlements are, if they're taking most of their holiday leave and living in their second home, they're going to struggle to get more. You know, the 25 days is probably quite ambitious for them to even achieve. So moving it beyond that, it's probably going to be very, very difficult for somebody that's, you know, a working person with a second home, you know, in Orkney particularly, where they've got to travel from elsewhere to come to Orkney. You know, that's, you know, four weeks and you've done it, but you probably don't have any, you know, other leave available. So, you know, for people with second homes that are retired, they can do it much more easily, but anybody that's working. So it was just that sort of thing. I think a lot of our second homes here are barely the 25 days, and that's probably about as much as they're occupied in the year.
Okay, thanks, Gareth.
Fergus, you wanted to come in.
Thank you. Yeah, just to agree with what Gareth said, really. I don't have an official figure, if you like, for occupancy of second homes, but I kind of agree with what Gareth said there. And just to come back to the point on Wales, all I know about what's happening in Wales at the moment is obviously local authorities down there have got the power to charge up to 300% premium on second homes. I think all I know is from a newspaper report, because it's so early days, but I think Gwynedd was the council that charged the highest premium at 150%, so didn't go anywhere near the 300%. And I think that early indications are that it is moving some second homes back onto the property market, if you like, in terms of maybe being for sale or let. But I think the issue is that still, I think the owners are still looking for high prices for these second homes, I suppose, in that area, and they're maybe not still accessible for, as affordable sort of properties, if you like. So that's the sort of the only early information I've had from Wales at the moment. I don't know if that helps, but and it's certainly not official. It's just something I've read.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Kimina. Good morning. I'm really interested in the discussion we've been having already on non-domestic rates and the small business relief scheme, how that might impact on the income generated by councils if this goes through. And, you know, all three council reps have talked about the modelling of income they might receive from this. And I wonder if you're concerned at all about behaviour change of second homeowners switching to short-term lets and then being eligible for small business rates relief, and that having an impact on the income that you generate at all. And I wonder if any of you have modelled that into your calculations or come to Bill first.
Well, I don't think we've done the exact modelling, but it's a really big question. I think there is a possibility that some people may, but we've no figures on how many may, how many may not. But it is a really, really big question, and it's something that we really need to get to the bottom of. And I think by using some process to remove the small business rates relief, I think would make a big difference.
Thanks, Bill. Any council colleagues online?
Fergus.
That is a really good question. The modelling that we've done so far is just assuming that there's no change in behaviour, but I know for a fact that there will be some changes in that behaviour. And incidentally, at the moment, the law is that properties in non-domestic rates to be a self-catering unit in non-domestic rates, they have to be actually let for 70 days were advertised for late for 140 days, and our assessor at West Dumbartonshire McGill and Butte Valuation Joint Board has been conducting a review of all self-catering units in McGill and Butte, over 2,200 of them, and they've been doing this review for a number of months, and we are seeing a number of properties failing that test and coming out on non-domestic rates and onto council tax as either second homes or long-term empty properties. So we've seen a bit of an increase already, and they haven't concluded the review yet. So I'm suspecting in the short term to see our second home numbers go up. But when we start to charge 100% premium on second homes from next year, I would see potentially them going back down, because people will be arguing that these properties have been actually let for 70 days. So, yeah, it's obviously, we might see a change in behaviour. It's difficult to anticipate exactly what that will look in terms of numbers. And I understand that the recent consultation from the Scottish Government were asking for information around about what councils might want to see in terms of maybe increasing the number of actual days let before a property come off of council tax and go back onto rates, or just qualify the self-catering unit for non-domestic rates. It's totally up for debate. Obviously, we'd be keen for these numbers to be pushed up a bit, but so it's harder for people to qualify for non-domestic rates. But it's going to be difficult. That is potentially a little loophole there that might want to look to try and close by increasing these figures in the rate side.
And Gareth, you wanted to come in too.
Change in behaviour, as Fergus has just outlined there, just like we'll see a change in some of the properties being sold, as people decide that it's expensive to have a second home that they're not making use of. Others will say, well, we want to hold on to it. How can we do this more cost effectively, and if we can shift it into non-domestic rates, we will pay nothing. And that's clearly something that all three councils are concerned about, and the small business bonus scheme that perhaps a lot of those short-term let properties could come across the council tax if we're not going to revise the small business bonus scheme, and perhaps with a discount. But bringing everything into council tax, in my view, would be something that could be done to everybody's, to council's advantage, and to the tax collected, and then the general funding of councils.
Okay, so Bill, you want to come back in, and also Fergus.
Yeah, every time we modify the charge to the council tax for properties, there's always a risk that there'll be a wholesale shift to non-domestic rates. But last time when we changed, it didn't materialise. So maybe it will this time because of the amount of change, but it certainly didn't last time. So there are many people, I would imagine, who will want to keep their property rather than use it as a short-term let.
Fergus?
Yeah, just to reflect again on behavioural change. And back in April 2014, we introduced a double charge on long-term empty properties in Argyll and Butte on the 1st of April 2014. And there was behavioural change then. And I think it's for avoidance again. A lot of people who had long-term empty properties were telling us that they're staying in these properties for more than 25 days a year, and therefore they were shifting over onto second homes, and therefore not getting the double charge. Again, that's behavioural change, and it's difficult to stop without having somebody sitting on a doorstep 24/7 looking at what's happening in these properties. It really is difficult to mitigate that behavioural change. But we did see a movement back then, and I think we're likely to see a bit of a movement again, but hopefully that'll be small numbers.
Thanks for that. And Fergus, you've touched on the next point I wanted to make, in that the government have consulted on a wider package. They've consulted on increasing the levels for long-term empty homes. They've consulted on changing the thresholds around short-term lets. And I just wanted to ask the whole panel whether you're happy that this is introduced in isolation on its own, rather than that holistic package that the government have consulted on, which could potentially stop some of the behaviour change and unintended consequences that we've spoken about. Maybe come to Ailey first.
Yeah, I think I would agree with you that a wider package of policy does need to be delivered. I think one of the problems is that particularly with short-term lets and non-domestic rates is, I think Fergus touched on this, is how do we actually know that these properties are let out for the time of length that they say they are? Because I know for a fact that there's lots of reputable people who operate secondary lets, but there's also some people who aren't. And they may as well, they can go in and book their own property for a certain amount of days and then submit that as evidence and then cancel the bookings as a way to get past the to get onto non-domestic rates and then apply for the small business rates relief. So I think, as I mentioned earlier, I know that we've the Scottish Government have introduced both licensing with the ability for local authorities to apply for control areas, which would allow them to use planning. But I think in the case of second homes, whether it be holiday homes or actually secondary lets, there should be consideration, again, given to local authorities to have a specific class use to better just at least so we have a sense of typology of these properties, but also to ensure that we can, but to better track them. I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, thank you. Bill?
Well, I think it would be really helpful to consider legislative and policy changes in an entire thing like this together. But obviously, we appreciate that that's maybe not possible as far as Scottish Government legislation is concerned. But certainly to deal with it holistically, I think would be an improvement rather than dealing it piecemeal in various different smaller bits and pieces. But I think that may be something for your decision rather than ours.
Thank you.
Timothy, you want to come in?
Yes, please. Thank you very much. And Mark, yeah, just picking up on that, I think a holistic approach is always welcome. But I think the missing piece potentially of the jigsaw or the area that the Scottish Government haven't looked at and should shine a light on is a review into the impact of all taxes impacting private landlords, because I think that potentially is part of the puzzle, because that will then lead on to perhaps the impact of where landlords have left the private rent sector and gone to the short-term lets market, which again impacts in this area on second homes. So I think we've long said that the Scottish Government should now do a review of all taxes impacting private landlords, the knock-on impact that that has had, certainly since the ADS supplement, and the impact on short-term lets as well. I think that would be a welcome piece of the puzzle in terms of information gathering in this area.
And Fergus, you want to come in too?
Really good that the Scottish Government are considering implementing or giving us the powers to charge double council tax on second homes next year. It brings it up to the same level of the increased council tax we charge on long-term empty properties. It'll make that sort of side of things a lot easier to administer for us. It means that avoidance between somebody that's currently got a long-term empty home and telling us that they're living in it for 25 days a year when clearly they aren't, then that stops that loop there. So I think I see this as an evolution. I think this is a really good start by giving us these powers next year. If they come to fruition, that'd be really good for us. And I do think after that, then, yeah, we need to probably have a more holistic look at all the other measures that might really help us get a handle on this and get a bit more control over second homes, long-term empty lets, the rate side on the self-catering units as well. I think a more holistic view later on would be great, but I think in the interim, I think this is a really good measure to implement for next year.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Some respondents to the consultation thought the proposal was unfair to second homeowners because of the use of local services less than permanent residents. And many have obviously already paid the additional dwelling supplement. Timothy, you've touched on this quite a bit already, but would you like to add any additional comments? Do you think that the proposal provides a fair balance between the general interest and second owners? And if you have any additional comments, that would be great. I know a lot of it's already covered.
Not too much to to add, I think what you know the feedback we get from members that it's not an effective policy area, and you know, and as I've said, there's other things that should be looked at. So nothing further sort of to add at this stage.
Thank you. Anyone else want to come in on that, Bill?
Well, certainly, we already charge basically 200% council tax on long-term empty properties. So I see little difference in that between holiday homes rather than long-term empty properties. And council tax is not direct taxation for whatever services we provide. You know, I don't have any kids at school. I still pay council tax. So I find that part of the argument to be a bit superfluous. You know, it's effectively local taxation for the provision of a total range of services. And I would also, I would disagree with what was said much earlier about ring fencing, because I think as far as the Verity House agreement is concerned, you have to, if we are allowed to raise this extra taxation, then you have to allow councils to decide how to spend it in their area or how much of it to raise. So I think that's really quite important.
Previous councillors, I totally understand that. Absolutely. Convener, the next question has been covered, so
okay.
Pop it back to yourself.
Thanks very much. Now I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan, who's joining us online.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I suppose just going back to Bill there, you've just said there already that you know you don't believe that money should be ring fenced, and I think that was something as well that somebody else touched on earlier there too. So I'm just wondering. I'm wondering what other thoughts are there around any restrictions around additional revenues that are raised, and how that should be used. And I'm also wondering about how is any additional income from reducing the council tax discounts in second home been used, and whether that's actually helped increase the supply of affordable housing.
I'm not sure that I quite got the question. So sorry.
That's okay. So I'm quite interested in whether other people agree that actually those additional monies shouldn't be ring-fenced. And I'm interested in whether any income from reducing the council tax discounts on second homes already, on whether that's helped increase affordable housing.
I think basically, in some cases, it has, because obviously we already have to ring fence for land banking. The first 40% of the charge was set in original legislation. So I think that subsequent legislation should not apply ring fencing and should allow the councils more options as to what, how we can deliver more affordable housing or what we should use the money for.
Thank you.
Fergus, you want to come in?
Yes, I just agree with Councillor Loban 100%. Obviously, we do ring fence over £2 million a year for the provision of affordable housing. That money goes into our strategic housing fund directly, and that's the value of the council tax we collect. Between the difference of the 50% discount on second homes and long-term empty properties and the 10%, that goes into the Strategic Housing Fund and is ring-fenced for affordable housing. But it's, the issue about providing affordable housing is more than just about money. It's not as simple as just create more funds to allow that to happen. So, and I think, as I said, as I've touched on before, we've got huge issues in terms of our small local communities. Not just a lack of accommodation for indigenous communities, but reducing the ability to maintain lifeline services such as fire, police, education and health, really, really important in these communities. And I think we should have the absolute flexibility, as per the Verity House Agreement, to use these additional funds in any way that we see possible to support these communities and across the whole of our Highland Butte. So we would definitely not support ring-fencing these monies.
Anybody else? Okay. Stephanie, no one else wants to come in on that one, if you want to move on.
That's fine then. So I suppose about the regulations providing a grace period, interested in that area as well, which if there's a purchase by a new owner, within 6 months for renovations, repairs being undertaken. So I'm wondering if they agree with that grace period, and do they feel that it will encourage empty home owners to bring their property back into use?
Yeah, I think we 100% agree with that proposal. I think that anything we can do to bring properties back into use, you know, irrespective of their use, it needs to be encouraged. But certainly we would really encourage anyone to bring the property back into use. And I appreciate the fact that if you take over a property which is really not a habitable standard, then we need to allow you some sort of grace period whereby it allows you to invest the money to bring it up to a standard and hopefully then bring it into a permanently occupied dwelling.
So, Bill, I suppose just right on that point there, do you feel the 6 months is adequate or do you feel there should be a bit more flexibility around that? What are your thoughts?
Again, I think there should be more flexibility. 6 months might be perfectly adequate if you're just upgrading a property, but if the property is semi-derelict, as some of them are, then it may take a bit longer than that. So I think council should be allowed discretion to decide almost case by case as to whether they should allow additional time or not.
That's great. Thank you.
Gareth and then Fergus.
Thanks. I think it's a very welcome thing to have the grace period. We've got some islands in Orkney where there are properties that are needing done up, but it's very, very difficult to get a contractor at the moment to go to the island. On the Orkney mainland, we've got probably an overheated building market. And, you know, for example, North Ronaldsay, with a fairly small number of properties, getting a contractor. There are no building contractors on North Ronaldsay, but getting a contractor to give up, you know, work on the Orkney mainland, where they're, you know, able to just, you know, leave home, go to work, to go out to North Ronaldsay, where they've got to stay over, is virtually impossible at the moment. And therefore, I think maximum discretion for the local authority on a case-by-case basis would be quite important, because it may take somebody there 2 or 3 years to persuade a contractor and to come up with the extra money that it's going to cost them to get somebody to come out and do up a house.
Fergus, and then Tim, the fee.
Yes, we definitely support this in terms of... For long-term empty properties, we definitely support this grace period. And we have been operating that way ourselves for a number of years since introducing the double charge on long-term empty properties. We've put in place our own policy around about that, and we have given a grace period for new owners. So at the moment, in terms of our policy, a new owner would get 6 months exemption from 6 months 50% discount from council tax to renovate, followed by a 10% discount for another 6 months if it's under repair. And then we've got a discretion to award another 12 months at 10% discount for people who are renovating their properties as well. So we give up to 2 years for a new owner to bring a property back into use before we'd hit them with a double charge. The reason for that is multiple. I suppose the policy's evolved over time. We have previously lost a valuation appeal committee. Well, we actually won the appeal because the decision that we made at the time followed the regulations, so we made no mistake there. But the panel made a very good recommendation that we ease our policy to allow more time for people to bring these properties back into use, because some of them are in quite bad state of repair. So that's why we've moved to 2 years basically before somebody would be affected by the double charge. And really, another issue for us is we're really struggling for planners at the moment. We're struggling to attract professional planners to the organisation. So because of that, sometimes our planning process can take longer than it should to get permission through. So that's another good reason why we should be delaying the double charge on these properties. And also, a lot of Argyll and Bute is in a conservation area, so there's loads and loads of listed buildings and loads of complications. So that's why we have our policy has evolved, and we allow up to 2 years discount effectively, some 50% discount, and then another 18 months after. So 6 months, 50%, up to 18 months at 10% discount, and then a potential double charge if it's not brought back into use. So we've got that currently as a policy, and that's why we think a grace period for empty homes is a really good thing to build into the regulations. But I absolutely would not support it for second homes.
Okay, thanks. That's kind of, you're clearly pointing to the need for the topography, this kind of nuanced approach to all these different properties. Yeah. Timothy, you wanted to come in.
Yes, thank you. I think, you know, Property, we would also welcome the 6 month grace period. It's certainly sensible. I think we would then want to advance this policy on in terms of, you know, decreasing the amount of empty properties. And I think certainly from conversations with our members, you know, some sort of grant funding, and certainly the Welsh Government have implemented a £50 million grant fund to get empty homes back into use. I think there could also be a separate fund for first-time buyers to access in terms of doing up and getting empty homes back into use. And I think that then plays into how more progressive can we be in terms of incentives. You know, if someone takes on an empty homes, renovates it, and fundamentally gets it back on the market into use for the needs of the local community and that local authority area, you know, what incentive should we be offering them in terms of a rebate on LBTT perhaps, or council tax, or these other taxes and charges that they you know, have incurred and will incur.
Okay, thanks for that. Stephanie, do you have any more questions?
Yes, just a final question from me, Convener. I'm interested in the panel's views and how the draft legislation actually links into the Scottish Government's long-term housing aims as set out in the Housing to 2040.
Anyone want to come in on that? Bill?
Well, you know, and again, I can only speak for Highland, but, you know, we're looking to build, or we need to build 14,000 new homes in the next 20 years, you know, of a variety of different classes. You know, some like 30% for general market housing, nearly 50% for social rent, and 20-odd percent for, I suppose, assisted rent. So things like that and ways that we can provide housing, anything that can assist has got to be a good idea. You know, when you've got something like 9,000 people on the housing and transfer list, it's in a small place like Highland, not geographically but population-wise, it's absolutely critical that we can think of some innovations that increase the supply of housing.
Thanks for that. Anybody else? Ailey?
Yeah, so just to echo what I said earlier, that obviously we need to increase supply, but it's absolutely prudent that we interrogate that form of supply. There's research that's come out of the London School of Economics, and as I understand it, pertains to England, but I think the sentiment can obviously pertain to Scotland, that if we're looking to bring back empty homes, say, as properties that people buy rather than council homes, it will actually further enforce the advantages accumulated by homeowners versus tenants. And it's really important that if we are going to take this holistic approach to deliver better supply, that it is social homes, because there's a chronic lack of supply of social homes in Scotland, as well as an over-reliance of the private rented sector. Again, I just wanted to say more about the general purpose of this policy in increasing and incentivising use. We know that council tax is particularly regressive for a number of reasons. I don't think I need to, I'm sure people in this room know why, but ultimately, if we want best use of property, then we need a look to replace the council tax and non-domestic rate system, ideally with something like a land value tax. Because the reality is council tax ultimately doesn't incentivise best use, and it, as the Scottish Government aimed to fulfil the Housing Strategy 2040, we do really need to consider quite radical changes to the broader housing market and how land is best used as well.
Yeah. Thanks very much for that. Do you want to say a little bit about why LVT would be would be better than council tax and NDR?
Yeah, so from a tenant's perspective, it council tax ultimately functions as a local property tax. The tenant doesn't own a property. And I understand, you know, it is for local services, but when there are cuts to things like council tax, it's working class people who face those cuts the most. In the instance of second homes and not paying premiums, it's second homes take away from local services, therefore the people like tenants and working class people tend to face those cuts the most. LVT, as it is designed, is and there's a number of ways in which you can administer it. And again, I'm no tax expert. I just have an interest in it. that it would be a taxation on the land and not the property. And therefore, it incentivizes use based on the way that is administered. And obviously, it wouldn't come at the cost of tenants or working class people either, because it would be for landowners or property owners. Yeah.
Okay.
I can send over further detail on that if you'd like.
Thank you. Yeah. Anybody else want to come in on Stephanie's initial question around the connection to the Scottish Government's long-term housing aims of housing to 2040? I mean, in a way, we've kind of talked around it, haven't we, a bit? But just an opportunity for anyone to say anything. We've got a bit of time in hand. Okay. I just want to cut. I'll bring them out. I'm just going to come back. Okay, hang on. All right. Lots of hands went up there. Okay. I just want to pick up. So I'm going to come in and ask a question around the grant funding. I thought that was interesting. Timothy, you bring that up. Then I saw Ailey, and then I'll bring in Mark. Okay. So, all right. So that's interesting. So Timothy, you brought in this idea that yes, the grace period, but then to move the agenda on around empty homes, and you had the suggestion of grant funding, and that Wales is doing that £50 million grants to get empty homes back up. And then also you had this idea of something for a first-time buyer fund. But I wonder, maybe this isn't a question for you, Timothy, it's a question for the councillors. I wonder what you think about that idea of money going to support the empty homes, people who've bought the empty homes. And what I'm interested in, and I don't know if this be possible legally yet, we might need to have legislation, but if there was something that, yes, there was a grant fund, but the somehow there's a that incentivizes the properties to be brought back into use, but that somehow the local authority gets a percentage of that. So, yes, there's money, a grant is invested, but then local authorities get something back out of the money made from those homes. Just wondered about that, because I feel like we need to kind of, rather than just giving away our public money all the time, we need to think about how do we incentivize what we want to have happen, but actually see returns coming to local authorities. Just on the hoof there. Bill, what do you think?
I think it's a really good idea. I think it shouldn't just be a gift of public funds for someone to bring a dwelling back into use. But I think if we're going to do any incentivisation, it has to be to bring homes back into permanent use. It's not something that we should be doing to allow someone to buy a holiday rental in the middle of nowhere that all that's standing is the gable end. So this must be a process to bring homes into permanent use. And if you end up with the councillors, for example, owning a golden share, so that if later on the property is sold, then that's something maybe we should think about. But I think that requires quite a lot of thought.
Yeah, certainly. And then there's also the idea of the rural housing burden that's being used quite a lot as well, which could be an interesting approach as well. Anybody else got any thoughts on that? Ailey?
Yeah, just to echo what Bill said, I think obviously ensuring that it is for permanent use, but particularly for social housing, specifically to say if we're going to say if the Scottish Government intend to allow people to renovate and stuff, that is not for secondary lets. There's a report that was given to Edinburgh City Council Planning Committee of June of this year. So is the economic impact of residential and short-term let properties, and this was during the consideration of the licensing scheme and also the control zone, in that it states the gross value added, the GVA, effects are greater for residential uses than short-term lets across all property types and areas. And I really think things like the GVA and community wealth building should also be considered with the implementation of these policies to ensure that the money remains within the local community and it is productive as well.
Yeah, for sure. Okay. Mark.
Thanks, Convener. If we're talking about this change affecting behaviours and potentially leading to second homeowners selling, then I would hope councils might be in a position to buy any of those homes being put on the market. And Timothy has talked about additional dwelling supplement applying to private landlords, but I wonder if council colleagues have any views on additional dwelling supplement still applying to councils, and whether that's something you would like to see removed so that you could support any buyback programmes to increase affordable housing supply, social housing in your own local authority areas, and maybe come to Bill first.
It's not something that we've actually actively considered, but you know, certainly it's an idea that is worth progressing. And certainly, you know, I presume other councils are the same as mine, that we do actually do buy houses on the open market these days, and would certainly be prepared to consider purchasing homes that, if they were affordable and they were the right properties in the right places, that we would consider purchasing them from people who are trying to divest themselves of a holiday home.
And what's your view on having to pay additional dwelling supplement as a local authority? It seems like almost a circular nature of tax than something that you should be exempt from.
Oh, I 100% agree with the fact that we should be completely exempt from the supplement. I don't think there's any doubt about that.
Thank you.
Okay, Gareth wants to come in on that one, I think. And then, Timothy, I'll bring you in later.
Gareth. Thanks, Chair. I think that the housing associations are exempt from LBTT, so they would not be paying the additional dwelling supplement. And so we've sort of tended to try and encourage the housing association, or it has influenced a number of purchases that the housing association have pursued. So because they're a charity, and I think that they therefore are exempt. So I think if local authorities were also made exempt, probably under the HRA has special VAT status if it had LBTT status as well. I think that would be particularly helpful.
Great, thanks. And Timothy, you wanted to come back? Oh, sorry, hang on a minute.
Timothy.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we'll just do that way. Timothy, come on in, and then Fergus, you want to come back on the ADS?
Yes, thank you. I think just to pick up on the grant funding, you know, there's also for local authorities whether there should be, you know, a speedier process for obtaining, you know, compulsory purchase orders, I think, as the last speaker alluded to, in order to purchase, or, as I said earlier, lease those properties so they're into use. The other point I just wanted to make was that in the Levelling Up and Regeneration Act, it's gone through Westminster. Within there's a policy proposal that could be mirrored or looked at and developed, in the sense of that legislation will give council powers to replace requirement on landlords to find tenants for a long-term vacant commercial property in towns and city centres. So whether, you know, across the country that policy area could be looked at in more detail and translated into empty homes. So you're almost, you know, local authorities have the more powers to compel owners to either, you know, living it, rent it out, or put it on the market for sale after a certain amount of time. I do think that area has been looked at in the commercial property space, and whether that warrants more development, more thinking in empty homes as well.
Okay, yeah, that's an interesting piece of policy to pursue. And Fergus wanted to come in. Yep, Fergus.
Yeah, just on the ADS and the ability for councils to purchase second homes, I totally agree with the comments from both Highland and Orkney councils. What I would maybe add is that maybe if we can combine some of that with more flexible funding from the More Homes Division, which would allow the purchase of some of the second homes in key locations which may come onto the market. This would allow the opportunity to prevent these homes from subsequently being used as anything other than principal homes. So really that would be really positive. And I think, if you don't mind, if I go back to the comment, the question about the grant funding as well, is that okay?
Yes.
So, yeah, I think that's a great thing as well. I think it's a really good idea. And I think if that was available, also maybe with powers for local authorities to maybe require planning permission when the property's been developed and brought back into use, we'd like maybe to have the sort of powers in planning so that any change of use of that residential property from a primary dwelling, you know, if we could have planning permission to check that, then that would be a good serious consideration. It would stop it maybe going back on as another second home going forward. So we'd really want that to be a primary residence. Another control might be that there could be an ability to place title burdens on new residential properties, which is not specifically applied for as a second home or holiday. Again, I think that those sorts of changes would be really useful around about the grant scheme that we talked about.
Okay, great. Thanks. Lots of things to pursue there, I think. Well, that brings us to the end of our questions. We do have a little bit of time if anyone feels like we haven't pursued anything in depth in any way. Not seeing anybody. Okay. So, well, thank you very much. It's been really helpful to have all your perspective. And as I said, I think we've unearthed some more areas to have a look at as well. I think our general objective here is to get more housing for people and to make sure that the priority is that people have a home before people have second homes. So next week we're going to be hearing from COSLA and the Minister for Public Finance and Community Wealth Building on the regulations at a committee meeting a couple of weeks from now on the 5th of December. And we previously agreed to take the next item in private. So as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.